I wanted to take a little bit of your time this afternoon to take you on a trip. It's a trip that I jotted down a few years ago in a little notebook like this. I try to keep one of these on me when I'm anywhere. This particular trip was across Arabia, east to west. I'll try to increase the size of this a little bit. So from Riyadh, in the upper right-hand corner, or midway there, down to Mecca and Taif. And then up through the hills to Taif is kind of the garden city of Mecca. Riyadh is the capital. I've transferred the relevant passages from my notebook of a few years ago to an iPad so I can manage it a little more easily. And I have a few slides here to go along with it, but mainly, let me tell you a story. This is a story about a few days' travel in a country that perhaps many of you have not visited. It begins on a Monday, February the 12th, in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. And from my journal, there is a present tense voice, and I'm going to read to you from it. I have found a man who will help me get to Mecca. His name is Captain Saeed. His office is in the National Guard Hospital Complex in Riyadh, and today, as we sit at his desk, he thanks me for helping him out. Captain Saeed's job is to make life easy for foreign diplomats visiting the capital. I've done him a favor this week, taking a piece of work off his desk by accompanying a UN representative from New York to some meetings with local officials here in town. And because I offered to escort this man, the captain hasn't had to. Now the UN man is safely on a plane back to Manhattan, and Captain Saeed looks relieved. "Is there anything I can do for you?" he asks. "This is the moment I've been waiting for." "Yes," I say. "I went to Mecca on the Hajj a few years ago. But I've never gone there just to visit. And right now, in February, Mecca is about as empty as it gets. I'd like to see this side of the town." Captain Saeed already knows that I'm a Muslim. He went to college in Boston, and nothing Americans say or do can surprise him very much. Mecca is on the other side of the country, across 600 miles of fairly serious desert. "I only have a few days, and I would like to fly." Captain Saeed has airplanes at his disposal, and he also has the means to manage pilgrim visas and reserve hotels. Tuesday, the captain's office. The next day, back at the hospital again, the captain pours me a customary teeny little cup of cardamom coffee and hands me a plane ticket and a visa. "Get through the airports early," he says. "Hardly anyone goes to Mecca in February. The soldiers at intake control will have plenty of time to look you over. It could take hours." And here we are in the air over the empty quarter, and my little notebook goes on. It's a standard small jet with 40 seats, most of them empty, and three flight attendants in uniforms and little pillbox hats with tidy scarves running down the ear. Below, out the window, the desert breezes by. Saudi Arabia is the size of Western Europe. I'm in a window seat, thank God, a terrible thing to pass over the largest sand desert on earth, strapped in an aisle seat. We rise over the capital, banking north, and come upon the Tuareg escarpment out the window, running on out of sight in both directions, north and south, 900 meters high in places, and including a complete middle Jurassic section still awaiting its geologists and paleontologists. The pilot flies so close you want to duck. The escarpment continues like this all the way to Yemen. No permanent rivers, no lakes. 10 years can go by without rain in this northeastern portion. But if you look closely at this little picture, which I'll try to increase the size of, you see down in the foreground of the picture, acacia trees growing in the shadow of a facing mountain. So nature is very clever in the desert, highly adaptable. In some parts of this escarpment, you find rock art as well. Bits of the same Proto-Arabic script that shows up in Sinai and in Jordan. You see human figures fighting with shields, throwing sticks, wildlife long since wiped out, ibex with backward-pointing horns, oryx with straight horns, ostriches, crocodiles, horseback riders, figures with outstretched arms. And along the road running west from Riyadh to Mecca, the road we occasionally cross as we fly, lie other examples. These petroglyphs at Musakiriya, for example. And here you can see a fair amount of the animal life. Up, particularly in the right-hand corner, it's quite clear because it's against some dark rock. This shows up in Saudi Arabia much more often than you would think. Well, I continue to be glued to the window as we fly along. And as a patch of rounded, low hills crosses the portal, a gentleman from the back of the plane approaches and sits down. He introduces himself as Dr. Amin, professor of history at a university in Mecca. I point out these hills to him, and Dr. Amin nods. He says, "You know, the Persian poet Nasiri Khosra, who traveled through here 1,000 years ago, describes these hills as mountains shaped like domes, bald and smooth as an egg." Dr. Aziz turns out to know quite a lot. He tells me how just north of here, the desert stretch from Mecca almost to Bahrain was for centuries a pilgrim's no man land. Only armed caravans were safe there. Poor Nasiri Khosra was traveling with just his brother and two friends, so for them, survival depended on paying a string of armed guards protection money to guide them from tribal boundary to tribal boundary. Khosra wrote that among these people, the word for stranger is the same word for prey. By the time he reached the oasis of Falaj, all he had left were two satchels of books. That was because the highwaymen couldn't read, and luckily neither could the people of Falaj. Though Khosra stayed there for 4 months, it isn't clear after 1,000 years where Falaj really was. But the word Falaj means this, and it does seem to indicate that there were palm groves, and Khosra himself talks about the mounds of dates which keep these people alive. Professor Amin doesn't subscribe to the popular critique of the modern Hajj as over-mechanized and artlessly tasteless. He says to me, "The roads are safe, the rooms are clean. I can't imagine being down there with a bunch of bandits on my tail kidnapping my children on the way to Mecca. Can you? Can you ride a camel? I don't know anyone who can, and I was born here." It's time for the second of the 5 daily prayers. It's called the midday or Asr prayer. And you know, observant Muslims, just as an aside, and he was one, pray wherever they find themselves when the time arrives. So it's like an appointment. Muslims consider prayer a kind of appointment. So sitting there next to me on the plane at 30,000 feet, without fanfare or any announcement, Professor Aziz executes his time out from the secular world in his seat, refraining from standing, bowing, the prostrations that you see sometimes on television when you see Muslims pray. Instead of going through the motions, he, with the top half of his body, he just does a little, barely perceptible, modest bends in his seat, little inclinations of a couple of degrees. You don't see this much on the flights to other cities in Saudi Arabia, but on the way to Mecca, people seem to have praying more on their minds. I see what he's doing, so I join him. And the minute we're done, the three flight attendants are beside us in the aisle with a tray and two little water cups. We each take a cup of water, but that's not why they're here. They're a flutter that a pale American like me should be performing the Muslim prayer. We were wondering, one of them says. She's from Malaysia, so we talk about it, and then we prepare to land. This is a very large and fancy airport, but I don't linger. Customs and security, as Captain Saeed warned me, can take hours. I do pass some pilgrims in their little white costumes in the corridor. Here's one. You kind of have to focus on this guy in the foreground. I think he's a Kashmiri, sitting on his haunches in this extremely modern-looking place, unperturbed and ready to get himself to Mecca as soon as he can. It turns out the guards are kind of sleepy. The place is virtually empty, and I'm quickly in a car on the road to Mecca. This is the road to Mecca. That's a little touch of Kleist Oldenburg's sculpture there. That's the Quran, just so you know where you're going. Mecca lies about 45 miles inland from the airport, in a valley, very narrow valley, about 900 feet above sea level, frequently floods. There are about 2 million regular residents there, but then when Hajj week occurs, that can triple. Coming into the little hotel about an hour later, the Egyptian desk man, Yasser, says, "You must be Mr. Michael." He and the Bangladeshi bellboy, Ibrahim, quiz me about America, and then Ibrahim and I ride upstairs to the seventh floor. The hotel windows are covered in carved old-fashioned wooden screens. They open out on a view of the mosque. Captain Saeed is good at arranging hotels. Two rooms and a kitchen, several beds, low-lying couches, fitted out to sleep six pilgrims. But it's off-season, and a lot of these places are empty. I'm paying $60 a night. Suddenly, the call to prayer rings out from the minaret outside my window. The call to prayer is almost an art form in Mecca, and today, the man with the vibrant voice sounds like he's standing in my shower. I haven't been in Mecca in 6 years, and a lot has changed. The downtown area surrounding the mosque has been transformed into a high-rise backdrop of palaces and new hotels. And across the way, I can see where the Ajyad fortress used to be the last time I came here. The Turkish Sultan built this fortress in the 1780s to protect the city. It seems to have been torn down. This fortress was an historic place. For one thing, Sharif Hussein, the last Hashemite governor of Mecca, fled from there, and as he was firing the shot that set off the Arab revolt in 1916, about which T.E. Lawrence wrote quite a lot. The disappearance of this fort was all over the media at the time that it vanished, the Turkish government bitterly protesting. And then the Turkish government built a 1/25th scale model of the fortress in Istanbul. So what is it with the Turks and the Saudis? I'll try to pop this map up here if I can to make it a little bigger. But essentially, you've got Riyadh in the central right-hand position there. And you can see that these other two along the Red Sea coast are marked vilayets. Those are Ottoman counties or states, you might say. And they were part of the Ottoman Empire for 500, 600 years. So you can see that the Ottoman Turks ruled Mecca and Medina until the Saudis finally conquered both cities by force in the early 1920s. Here is the Turkish miniature of the fortress that you saw. It's in a park in Istanbul. Apparently, the Saudi authorities have now promised to reconstruct the fortress elsewhere, but that's probably a shell game, a game of hide the castle. They not only knocked the place down, they destroyed the huge granite hill that it sat on. So they were making way for a clock tower and a bunch of hotels. Everybody knows about that. But some people also suggest that tearing this castle down may have been a tit for tat. And I think I see what they mean. Over on the other side of Arabia, near where I've just come from 2 centuries ago, the Turkish army destroyed and burned to the ground the original home of the first Saudi dynasty. It was a fortress city called Dariya. Dariya was destroyed in retaliation after a Saudi army rolled over here from the east, rolled to Mecca from the east, and briefly occupied both Mecca and Medina. That was the first time they occupied it. They were dislodged in 1812 by an Egyptian viceroy of the Ottoman Sultan. A little later, they burned Dariya to the ground when the Saudis resisted. And after they burned Dariya to the ground, the Saudis simply moved a few miles north and began to build their present-day capital, Riyadh, which I showed you earlier. Well, things happened very slowly in those days, but nothing seems to be forgotten. So, a century later, in 1925, the Saudis reconquered Mecca for the second time. And they united the lion's share of the peninsula into the nation we now know as Saudi Arabia in 1932. And they took another 40 years to begin to rebuild Dariya, but you can see by the crane in the background that rebuild it they have. Purely as an historical monument to their ancestors, no one lives here, and now the Ottoman fortress in Mecca is gone, unless you count the miniature in Istanbul. This is a long shot of Dariya, as it looks now. Actually, I think they're talking about putting a suburb in around it. So, you know, this is not very far from Riyadh anymore. It was some distance 15 years ago, but there's been a lot of building going on. So, politics aside, all of this raises an interesting phenomenon for art historians dealing with Arabia. And that is the practice of what you might call preservation by modern reproduction. Rewriting the sandbox of today, rewriting in the sandbox of today, a centuries-long east-west regional conflict that is the peninsula's real history and frequently covered up. Well, so that afternoon, I went downstairs and I found a gate and walked into the Grand Mosque of Mecca, the biggest mosque in the world. And my notebook picks up here. The place is fairly spare right now, very sparsely populated. This is a picture from the turn of the century, and honestly, there were not very many people there today, maybe 10,000 altogether. The escalators and the stairs leading to those upper stories were cordoned off. Everyone's on the first floor. In the 1930s, however, this would have been a crowd, a big crowd. Today, it takes me 10 to 15 minutes to walk through the outer galleries of this building into this open-air center that you're seeing here. And there, at the edge of a polished marble floor, I stand on a kind of elevated, well, I had a picture of it. I stand on a kind of elevated railing and watch the pilgrims making their circuits around the two-story black draped shrine, which you see at the center here. The mood today is quiet, self-contained, a notable absence of the Hajj frisson. Captain Saeed was right about that too. I'm watching about 3,000 men and women perform something called the tawaf, which just means turning. This is the first ritual you do when you come to Mecca, whether you're on Hajj or just visiting. And I watch for a little while because I'm not quite sure where to begin and how it goes. It's been some years since I've been here. And while I'm watching, beside me at the railing, I hear a man speaking softly. It takes me a minute to realize he's talking to me. We introduce ourselves. He's an elderly gentleman from Lahore, by way of Paris, where he works for the World Trade Organization. His name is Rafiq, and his English is French accented. We go on talking, standing side by side, admiring the shrine. "It's really powerful just seeing this," he says, and I agree. This close-up, the two-story cube and an embroidered drape, is at once stationary but wavering just a little because of the slight breeze kicked up by people circling it. It makes the cover wave a little and shimmer. The Spanish poet Ibn Arabi in the 13th century called this breeze the result of angels' wings. It's a little poetry and mysticism of Islam. Rafiq continues, and yet it's all symbols, you know. It's just a stone cube on a marble floor with nothing in it. And then on the other hand, it's the house of God, because that's what we call it. We agree on that, and so it is. Rafiq falls silent for a minute. I can't think of anything more to say either. Muslims look at this very ancient building as marking the direction of prayer. When they come here, they walk around it as a reminder to keep the sacred at the center of your life. Later, I'm down on the floor turning around the building in a crowd when somewhere in the Fifth Circuit, a venerable-looking Turk with an impressive length of beard accosts me in the procession and asks where I'm from, saying, "Germany? You Deutsch?" I say, "No." He says, "Sprechen Sie Deutsch?" And lo, I manage to retrieve a few sentences, although I haven't tried my German in about 25 years. He really wants to get a conversation going, although we are going around. And I oblige him for half of the next turn, but it's not really done to carry on small talk while you're executing this rite. And I find it distracting anyway, and then my German fades out, and finally he drifts away. By the time I leave the mosque, it's long past dark. You see a lot of stray cats here. I watch one leap off a wall into the open. Get this up here a little larger. You see a lot of stray cats here. I watch one leap off a wall into the open chute of a garbage truck, taking her chances. Mecca has a lot of beggars, too, the most discreet people you've ever seen. One, a rail-thin, white-bearded man, introduces himself at a corner. "Where are you from?" I say, "California." He says, "Me, Kashmir, Mujahideen." I nod, he nods, and then he rubs his fingers together and wrinkles his eyes. Panhandling is forbidden here. He could be thrown in jail if we were noticed. When I glance over again, he rubs his stomach. I nod and walk beside him for an acceptable length of time and then reach into my trousers, hoping not to pull out the $650 bills that are my stake for the next few days here. I latch onto a little clump of 10 real notes, each worth about $250. I fold one up inside my pocket and slip it into his waiting hand, and he vanishes instantly. Back upstairs in the room again, I pull a couch to the window and watch the mosque some more. It never sleeps, and the people are fascinating. The telephone rings. It's Captain Saeed in the capital. He wants to know how the room is. Saturday, a trip to Taif. I want to have a look at the mountain south of Mecca, so I take a day trip with two young Saudi guys to Taif. Only Muslims can go to Mecca, but anybody can travel to Taif. Taif has been Mecca's summer retreat for centuries. We set out after lunch driving through these low foothills, lots of water around. I have a specific place I want to find here, the long deserted Ukaz market grounds. From a couple of very old photos and some reading, I've built up an impression of this deserted rocky plain as the very early site of a big, bustling medieval trade fair, drawing visitors from as far south as Yemen. One of the old photos shows a half-toppled arch and a broken wall. In the days of the Prophet Muhammad in the late 6th and 7th early 7th centuries, this Souk Ukaz was the richest market ground in the region. Muhammad used to come here as a boy with his uncle, a wealthy trader, Abu Talib. That was 1,400 years ago. It's mentioned in most of the chronicles, this place, Souk Ukaz. Today, no one seems certain where it was. Of my two companions, Badr has never heard of the place. Ali recalls the name, but nothing more. Soon we're climbing through hairpin turns on a modern highway held up by bridge struts straddling deep canyons. The peaks ahead, which you can see here, make up in steepness for what they lack in height. There is no tree line because there are no trees. Off the road, at an overlook, we gaze back down into a dramatic looking valley 6,000 feet below. A few miles on, we stop for a trio of baboons feasting on pita bread. Ali says, I didn't know baboons baked. We drive into Taif, past the first stoplight. We turn in at a filling station and ask some directions. An old man with a face like a walnut stands at the counter wearing a red checked scarf. He informs us that the market grounds of Souk Ukaz are long, long gone. 100 years ago, you might have found it. Now, new buildings everywhere. The old things are finished. Pleasant-looking town, Taif, prosperous without big city flash. Pedestrians dotting the sidewalks, sparse cars flowing evenly. Amid buildings of 4 and 5 stories, you see a lot of public gardens. We stop at a crosswalk to ask some directions. We stop at a bus stop, too. Then we stop at a trucker's depot. No one seems to have heard of Souk Ukaz. And then we strike pay dirt. A man in Trotsky spectacles with a book under his arm directs us with great certainty 40 kilometers east of town. A stranger overhearing him concurs. The stranger turns out to work for the Ministry of Tourism. 40 kilometers east, he says, and he gives Ali the name of the highway exit. We set off in a rush, no time to eat. And by the time we leave town, go out through the circular road and hit the highway, it's already a little after 2. The sun behind us begins throwing long shadows. We turn at an exit and follow a wire fence frontage road. We go for about a mile. And then to our right, on a dirt track, there's a line of bumps on the horizon. We train the binoculars that way and scan what looks like an intact stone fortress on a rise. Coming closer, we see it is a fortress, but reconstructed. The work is very precise and tidy, too tidy to be anything but recent. But behind that, and scattered into the distance, sun-baked mud brick structures of greater age, dilapidated, going back to earth. And mud walls, and more mud walls, and mud enclosures with what look like doors. The grounds here are all marked out with demarcation lines of broken rock. You can see one a bit to the, well, it's in the center there, that photograph. What is it about a pile of disassembled rock that evokes excitement? Put a person near a ruined site and they start acting like Indiana Jones in about 5 minutes. Even Badr, who has no idea what this place might be, takes to wandering over the rocky ground, picking up stones and staring at them. I snap some photos and go over to him. nearer, I see he's holding a couple of white stones the size of peach pits, and one in each hand, and striking them together. He says, you know, 30 years ago, my grandmother used stones like these to make fire. People who were too poor to afford electricity or even matches lit their cooking fires this way. The stones look like quartz. He strikes them again, no spark. Maybe they're too small to work, he says. I grab a couple off the ground, put them in my pocket, go on taking pictures. Bader. Some work has been done out here. There are numerous unmortared rock enclosures. There's a broad expanse of stony ground. There's been some people here prior to our visit, either archaeologists or folks from the National Museum. Someone's had a hand here. There's a reconstructed fort. And there are occasional reconstructed enclosures, too. Market enclosures, they're described in the Chronicles as looking something like this. A grave site, two grave sites. A couple of hours later, we start back down the mountain road. We see, we take a different turning going back and roll past an Ottoman tower, and then a few miles further on, another tower, just like it. I tell Ali to pull over, but the light's already failing. He says, it's gonna be too late. For what, I ask? The camel track, he says. What camel track? You'll see, he says, if we get there before the sun sets. Later for the Ottoman towers. To save time, we take a circular road around the center of Taif, and a few miles later, at the overpass above the valley, he pulls over and we get out. He points and I squint. Almost hidden across this photograph, hidden in the blasted looking canyons, there's a winding path so steep that it seems unreal. It's an ancient track that the caravans once took, he says, traveling north from Yemen up to Mecca. In the Middle Ages every year, in pilgrim season, traders leading lines of camels wound their way north over this ribbon of rock, delivering Yemen's wheat and fruit to distribution depots like Sukukaz. This was the Arabia Felix of the Middle Ages and the antiquity, Yemen. In Muhammad's time, in Charlemagne's time, they carried carpets up here, camel hair tents, sheepskins, pottery, tools, jewelry, perfume, produce, spices. Sukukaz was never an inhabited settlement. It was a seasonal fairground connected to the Hajj by roads like this. They came every year during the months when war and raiding were forbidden, during the months of the pilgrimage. They passed through unmolested and they camped for a few days at places like this. They sold and they bought before traveling a few miles further west and finally attended the Hajj and then went home. As we gaze down the trail, Ali cups his hand over his ears. Listen, I hear a breeze. Maybe it sounds like camel bells, he says. We continue on downhill through the hairpin turns. We see a few of these creatures along the way, a family of six. This is a very small photo, but this is the new road in contrast to the camel track running between Taif and Mecca. It's pitch black in the back seat before the road starts to flatten out. I sit back and watch the headlights on the road, and after a while, I dig the two white stones out from my pocket and strike them together in the dark, and they make a spark. I show Bader. Do you think that was really Sukukaz? I ask, and Bader shrugs. Maybe 50-50, Ali says. We can come back tomorrow. But tomorrow I'm flying home. Thank you.